Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the committee in 2015. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members may consult tablets during the meeting. This is because we provide meeting papers in digital format. Agenda item one today is our seventh oral evidence session on the Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Bill. Today we are taking evidence from the British Transport Police and Police Scotland on the provisions relating to scrap metal dealing, alcohol licensing, taxi and private hire car licensing and sexual entertainment venue licensing. Before we start, can I point out to the witnesses that you don't need to press the buttons on the microphones. They will be operated by the sound engineer. I'd like to start the session off with questions on scrap metal dealing, on which British Transport Police take the lead, so we should direct our questions to them. Once we've exhausted all of our questions on scrap metal, British Transport Police witnesses will step down from the table and we'll continue the rest of the session with Police Scotland. I'd like to welcome from the British Transport Police Chief Superintendent John McBride, Divisional Commander for Scotland, and Superintendent Alison Evans, National Metal Theft Taskforce of the British Transport Police, and then from Police Scotland, Assistant Chief Constable Nelson Telfer, Head of Policing West of Scotland, and Chief Inspector Morag Stewart, Liquor and Civic Licensing Policy, Police Scotland. Chief Superintendent McBride and Superintendent Evans, can I start by asking if you have any opening remarks that you would like to make on the scrap metal provisions in the bill?
If I start, so I'm providing evidence of the activity that's been undertaken in England and Wales. Looking at the Scrap Metal Dealers Act that was put into provision there in December 2013 as part of the suite of measures that we've undertaken around metal theft, and with the whole aims of that, of making metal harder to steal, so putting protection in there and trying to work with the industries to make sure that we try to make metal as safe as possible by either marking it or increasing the or enhancing the protection around it, making it easier for offenders to be caught. So our enforcement measures that we undertook as part of the task force, making sure that we did the joined up activity between Home Office Forces, BTP, and importantly our other agencies, so people like the Environment Agency and local authorities, who had a huge part to play in this. So I think it's important to put that into context, to see the Scrap Metal Dealers Act as it came in, as part of, in the round. It was hugely important. It's been very necessary and it's been very helpful, but it is only part of the activity that's been undertaken. The results for us speak for themselves. So in 2012-13, England and Wales saw a 43% reduction in metal theft overall. And that's all types of metal theft, so cable, power cable, media cable, theft of lead from church roofs, catalytic converters. So we're talking the whole round. We need to not make sure that we don't just think about metal as being the cable that we usually associate it with. That was matched by BTP figures as well. And in the year 2013-14, BTP saw a further 36% reduction. Now, we haven't got the figures for England and Wales for the year 2013-14. They're due to be published imminently, but unfortunately I haven't had foresight of those. But what we're being told by the forces that we're working with, anecdotally over the previous year, they're seeing a similar sort of reduction. So we're looking at around, certainly for BTP, an 80% reduction. You would expect, having had those decreases, that there's no way that that could be continued. But at the moment, since April 2014 onwards, we're still seeing just under a 50% reduction, 48% reduction, both in our live and non-live crimes. When we talk about live crimes, we're talking about cable that affects the running of the railway, so the signalling equipment that stops the trains running. But there's also still thefts that go on from depots, from line side, that don't necessarily affect the running of the railway, but still have a huge impact and a financial cost to Network Rail. So although I can't say that those figures are completely reflected within England and Wales as a whole, it's indicative, I think, of the successes that bringing in the Scrap Metal Dealers Act, particularly with the cash ban, particularly with the licensing requirements, the effect that it's actually had. We've worked with the Local Government Association very closely on this, and also with the individual local authorities. Nobody there has indicated to us that they've seen any particular increase in fly tipping, that they've seen that correlation between the Act coming in and an increase in the financial requirements on them to act upon that. And although the BMRA indicated when the Scrap Metal Dealers Act came in that their members have seen a downturn in the income coming in, HMRC have done some testing around the returns for tax returns, and they certainly have seen nothing that they can link to suggest that there is a downturn. Now, it may be considered that the tax returns of scrap metal dealers, even the BMRA, I think, would time to say that they've been careful about how they've managed their tax returns. So you might not think that that's particularly indicative, but we've tried to do some testing as we can around it, and that's what we found. We haven't seen any particular links to a cash ban, to a downturn in resources. You've asked about cash checking facilities.
If we'll probably question some of these things.
Okay.
Can I ask Chief Superintendent McBride if you want to come in on any of these points?
Yes, just a couple of things. Thanks, Chair. A lot of what Alison has described there took place under, or still takes place under, the National Metal Theft Task Force, and Scotland has indeed played into that and replicated much of what has been played out in England and Wales. So coordination of operations between ourselves, Police Scotland, and before that the constituent forces, together with SEPA and other agencies who have some locus in this type of criminal activity. So lots of coordinated policing operations, targeting different angles and working with utilities, both transportation, telecommunications, power generators and suppliers, around housekeeping, disposal, preventative measures that would help tighten down, and also working with local authorities. And I suppose what we've seen there, Alison's described there, some falling crime rates in England and Wales, both in BTP in England and Wales and the Home Office forces. The reduction on the railways here around crime has been more modest than what the rest of the force has seen, despite taking much the same action. And what we've seen across the board in terms of crime figures in Scotland is actually a slight increase. Now, of course, I suppose the part that's different in this complicated arena is the change in legislation in England and Wales. And I'm really hopeful and welcome what the committee are progressing here, that the changes in registration and licensing in the scrap metal dealing industry, who primarily are the market makers, will reduce crime in Scotland even more.
Do Police Scotland have anything to add at this point?
Nothing to add at this point, Convener,
thanks. Thank you very much, and we'll move on to questions. The committee have heard a fair amount of evidence of the impacts of metal thefts, and I'm looking at a press report from the Hamilton Advertiser here, which talks about thefts from Aikenhead Farm, Tannock Side, of 200 metres of cable carrying 11,000 volts. It's quite unbelievable to think that folks would risk life and limb for that. But this seems to be quite commonplace. We've got incidents galore listed, and we know that there have been major impacts in the railways over the piece. You suggest in your submissions that there should be the creation of a national register of metal dealers. Would you like to comment on why you think that there should be a national register? Can we start with the British Transport, please?
Yes. Please. A national register would be really helpful, I think, from a number of points of view. I think for members of the public who are looking to dispose of household waste and metal, it would certainly help them to identify, if you like, recognised and bona fide scrap metal dealers would be the first thing. From an enforcement point of view, there is good information and intelligence opportunities to be shared amongst a number of law enforcement agencies who have some jurisdiction in this issue. So sharing of information on a if you like, a business by business basis with SEPA, with local authorities who have some locus in this, and ourselves when we visit scrap metal dealers would be really useful. It's also really useful to be able to see and have some clarity over who has registration and licensing and which local authorities, not just for scrap metal dealers, but also for the itinerant mobile collectors, to have visibility on that.
Okay. Police Scotland, do you have a view on that, National Register?
Certainly our view in the National Register would support what Chief Superintendent McBride's just emphasised in terms of regulation and the sharing of information and intelligence. So we would welcome that and support our colleagues' position on it.
Chief Superintendent McBride, you mentioned itinerant dealers there, and the committee has also heard about waste dealers who may also deal in smaller amounts of metal. How do we deal with these folks and ensure that they are staying within the law? Because we have heard from others that may be much more difficult to actually deal with in police.
I think one of the aspects that would strengthen the regulation is the definition around dealers, and that should, I would offer, include those who buy or sell, and through that mechanism we would catch a number of itinerant or mobile collectors within the legislation. In operations in Scotland, and the experience will be similar in England and Wales, the itinerant and mobile collectors, whilst they do a social good in terms of some of the scrap metal that they uplift, there is considerable evidence that there's an element of them that will steal metal. And of course, that gets into the chain in terms of the selling into unscrupulous dealers. And so we have, if you like, harm done to communities, local communities. There's evidence of furniture, garden furniture, trampolines being taken out of gardens. There's been a proliferation of metal collectors because the value was such that it made it, a good low-risk, high-reward crime to become involved in. So I think if the legislation could be strengthened as the committee scrutinises it to include itinerant and mobile collectors, that would be really, really valuable, and we would prevent a fairly significant section of this industry sitting out with the legislation.
Superintendent Evans, how have itinerant dealers been dealt with in England and Wales, please?
Each mobile collector is required to have a licence for the local authority area that they collect in. There's been some discussion about the display of those licences, and with mobile collectors saying, if we collect in several areas, how are we meant to display them? We would have licences all over our windows and it wouldn't be safe, which is slightly ridiculous because they're only required to display the one in the area that they're actually collecting at that time. So. Some local authorities have gone down the photographic route. That's really helpful so that people don't swap over their collector's licences to other people. It gives great reassurance to the public, so the public know that if the licence is on display, then the person who comes to their door asking for any metal, they can check that they are genuine, they are legitimate. So there's reassurance to the public. It makes our life easier when we do roadside stops, because we can see immediately this person's got a licence. We can check their records. If they're keeping the appropriate records, then they can go on their way. So we make sure that we focus our activity on the people who are totally contravening the activity, who will be contravening environmental legislation's likelihood as well. So working with partners in the roadside operations that Mr. McBride has described, but making sure we've got all the parties to the table so that we can... If they're not keeping the appropriate records, we can seize loads or whatever we need to do as necessary. Thank
you. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Good morning. I noticed in your submissions that you're interested in a national register and a requirement to display ID. Are you absolutely convinced? And also the banning of cash payments. Do you think that's going to help a lot? The problem we've had with other witnesses is they can have a check and then go next door and cash it. How would you stop that? That's the other question.
Who's going to tackle that first? Chief Superintendent McBride, please.
There's no doubt that the availability of cash within the industry leads to poor business practice, if I can put it that way. There's good evidence that there are scams within the industry, probably driven by the availability of cash. And therefore, I would really support this prohibition that is suggested in the bill that will take away, if you like, some of that temptation. But more importantly, the availability of the cash is in some ways what greases the wheels of the criminality, because it allows for absolutely no traceability in the transactions. The record keeping where it's poor and designed to wrong foot any investigations provides anonymity. And those two things combined ease the criminality that's involved. So if we can prohibit the use of cash by introducing a mechanism that gives us some traceability, either through non-transferable checks or electronic payments, that would be really useful. I think your point is really well made, that they may very well go to a check cashing outlet to cash that check. And that moves us into an area of money service bureaus and businesses that also bring in a considerable amount of regulation from HMRC and the Know Your Customer checks, where identification is required initially to create that relationship. In some ways, the regulations and the requirements around Know Your Customer are much more stringent than anything we have ever seen around the registration and record keeping in the scrap metal dealing industry. So I would fully support a prohibition on the use of cash to buy or sell scrap metal.
Okay, thank you. Have you?
Once again, convener, just to emphasise our full support for our colleagues in BTP, their position on it. Nothing further to add.
Okay, Cameron.
Keen on photographic ID, which is essential, I would have thought. Is it photographic ID for everybody? And the display of licences, I think you answered the point that when there's one licence and you're in a particular area, you just display that licence. I think that's answered the point. Thank you.
Okay, grand, thank you. Claire Adamson, please.
It was just a quick supplementary on the evidence, if I could ask. Chief Superintendent McBride, you talked about the definition of tightening up the definition, but the phrase you used was someone who buys or sells. Should that be someone who buys and sells? Because I'm conscious of at what point would an ordinary householder become requirement for a licence if they're just selling metal?
I think the specific part, and that's why I was careful the way I worded that, is actually to capture everyone who's involved in this. And we talked before briefly about itinerants and mobile collectors, because they do not always buy on the doorstep. They may be given. Yeah. So it's important that is in there, that it's not buy and sell, because they're not always buying. Mm-hmm. And that may just create a loophole in the legislation for some people who are of a mind to try and step around it.
So for an individual householder who's maybe selling, as you say, trampolines or used garden furniture, but whatever, how would you measure at what point a licence would be required? Would that be on the bulk of the sales in a particular time, or the value of sales, or?
So I see what you mean, just around the householder. Yes. Then I think there's provisions in England and Wales that cater for that. Mm-hmm. And I don't think there's anything suggested in the draft bill as it is that would make us any different in that regard.
The point that Ms. Adamson is trying to get to is, you know, that sometimes in our lives we may get rid of excess, whatever it may be. So in terms of the England and Wales provision, is there something about the regularity of buying and selling would be the thing, rather than some of us who maybe had that bit of garden furniture or whatever as a one-off selling it and suddenly finding ourselves in breach of the law?
Within the England and Wales Act, it talks about the business, carrying out a business as a scrap metal dealer. And within that, the role within that business, they buy or sell. So it would exclude myself, yourself, on a one-off basis or on an irregular basis. So it's that business proposition, if you like. But within that, we would like to see that it said buy or sell, so that it would include the mobile collectors who don't buy but who definitely do sell. Does that make sense?
Interject, if the records are kept better and would allow the power of entry inspection, we would be able to ascertain if somebody is coming there quite frequently and they actually don't have a licence, and then we could take that forward. So that would capture and deal with that element as well.
As it stands at the moment, the draft bill says that the section applies where a metal dealer or an itinerant metal dealer, the dealer, in the course of the dealer's business, A, acquires any metal, whether or not for value, or B, processes or disposes of any metal by any means. Would that be similar to the English and Welsh legislation? Thank you. Okay. John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. And it's first question is to Superintendent Evans. Superintendent Evans, you gave an example earlier in terms of the mobile itinerant collector, and you said that in England and Wales, those collectors are registered in every local authority they operate in. Is that correct?
Yes.
Because at the present moment, as I understand the current legislation in Scotland, is they only need to be registered in one local authority area, but they can collect in other parts of Scotland. And I wonder if Police Scotland or Transport Police would have any comments about whether or not it would be appropriate to actually introduce a licensing regime that is ties into the question raised earlier by the convener about the national licensing regime to ensure that anybody who is an itinerant or mobile collector is actually covered, rather than some of the issues that were raised previously, where if someone is stopped in the Highlands and has a licence in Glasgow, it's how they actually check that out.
Who's going to tackle that first?
If you did have a national register or a Scottish register, then anybody who stopped somebody with a licence from Glasgow in the Highlands would be able to check that national register to make sure that that licence was legitimate.
Thank you. Police Scotland, do you have a...
It's similar to the way that peddler certificate operates. Although the police issue the peddler certificate, they're allowed to operate throughout Scotland. Obviously, in England, they're licensed on a local authority basis, which might keep tighter controls.
Just a clarification, Chief Inspector Stewart. The police in Scotland at the current time issue peddlers' licences.
Yes.
Has there been any discussions with Police Scotland about issuing the itinerant mobile collector's licence?
No, it's the local authority that would issue itinerant metal dealer's licence.
Is it just trying to work out why the police would issue peddler's licences and not...
Well, a peddler's licence is given for the sale of goods and wares, whereas a metal licence is specific to you're actually a dealer in metal as opposed to other ancillary items.
So you already have a national register for peddlers in Scotland? And you operate that national
We will
register.
Have records of those that have been issued with a licence.
Right, thank you. Just another question, and other members can comment on this, Convener, is once again Superintendent Evans made reference to the issue about the, and it's one of the areas that has been raised by the committee, if we cut out this, introduce the cash for scrap issue, then what the scrap metal dealers have told us is there may be an increase in fly tipping. And it's just that I think, Superintendent Evans, you made reference to the levels of fly tipping, and it's not really seen any relationship to the introduction of the new legislation in England and Wales.
Superintendent Evans, please.
I have to say, when we looked at working with local authorities to draft, and the Home Office, etc., to draft the bill, that wasn't it something that, as far as I'm aware, we even thought that might be an issue. So good that it has been raised here and you're considering it. And that's something that we need to take back. But certainly it's not something that, even when we're talking on a one-to-one basis with local authorities, they're telling that individuals have found it a problem. And working as a whole with the Local Government Association within England and Wales and the Environment Agency, there's nothing that has been raised at all. either on an individual or national basis, to suggest that that has occurred. No, I'm happy to take back and go and ask those questions and see if there is and maybe submit some written evidence to you if that would be helpful.
That would be extremely useful, Superintendent Evans, if that were possible.
No further questions.
Okay, thank you. Willie Coffey, please.
Much, convener, and good morning. I just wonder if I could pick up on the cash ban issue and how well it's been working in England and Wales. Presumably, cash transactions are therefore criminalised now in England and Wales. Is there any evidence to support that criminal activity and data gathering to show how that's proceeding? I mean, it would perhaps be a wee bit naive of us to think that there is no cash transactions taking place anymore because of your legislation down there, but how has that panned out? Are there any prosecutions in relation to cash transactions?
Superintendent Evans, please.
Yes, there have been prosecutions in various parts of the country for dealing in cash, for not keeping appropriate records, for not checking the identification. So all parts of the legislation have been enforced. Well, part of the work that we've done, as well as with the judiciary, educating them around how important it is that we have the cash ban in place. So those people who have contravened it have got more serious fines. We haven't had any imprisonment sentences for it, but have got more serious fines for it, anything ranging up to £1,000 for contravention of the Act.
Do you think that's made the biggest contribution to that quite impressive reduction in the number of mental theft? Deaths that are taking place, because the figures you mentioned were quite impressive.
It's taken out the ability of low-level offenders to process their metal without any risk and to get the immediate reward for it. And that was what was so easy for them previously. Metal is relatively untraceable, so it's difficult to make it so much harder to steal because it's so prevalent within our communities. So we had to think of another way of doing it. So that's looking at the middleman, getting the cooperation of the scrap metal dealers to make those enhanced checks. So they're almost put by having the identification checks, policing it themselves to a certain extent. We had to get the legitimate industry on board. So in order to do that, you've got to show them that you're taking taking enforcement activity against those who are contravening. So if you've got the legislation, our learning was we really have to show the legitimate industry that we're doing something about it, we're taking out the bad guys, because otherwise they don't have any faith in us. They won't keep giving us intelligence. We haven't got that many resources, so we've got to focus them on the people who are really taking the stolen metal through them and just not even thinking about the legislation. So the cash ban for us were hugely important because it takes out that immediate realisation. It puts another step in the way, another way of identifying somebody who's handed in stolen metal. And it puts another step in, that they've another hoop they've got to jump through before they've got cash in their hand for the metal that they've sold.
Chief Superintendent McBride, you wanted to come in there too.
Thanks, convener. I just thought it might be helpful to share. In France, when they introduced a cash ban, actually the evidence that they found between members in the industry and having a level playing field between those legitimately playing within the law and those who were out with it, then there was quite a lot of reporting from within the industry in France which allowed the police there to target their operations on those operating out with the law. And there's been a similar experience in England and Wales where, if you like, competitors have been reporting through their own intelligence networks in the industry where people are not operating within the law. And we would expect to see a similar experience here if the provisions of the bill came to be.
Thanks for that response. Convener, I wonder if I could ask a question in relation to the 40-hour requirement of both Transport Police and Police Scotland. You've both said that you would prefer to retain the requirement to keep metal on site for 48 hours, but we have heard in evidence at previous sessions that perhaps the police are not always able to investigate metal theft within 48 hours. Could you respond to that and give us your advice on that, please?
Chief Superintendent McBride first, please.
Thanks, convener. As part of our minimum standards of investigation that have been written up in BTP, shared in England and Wales, and actually shared with colleagues in Police Scotland, when there is a metal theft attack on the railway, part of our minimum standards is to visit the three closest scrap metal dealers with a view to looking for the metal that has been stolen. The 48 hours would be really helpful to us. The reality is, I understand and the BTP understand the pressures in the industry. They are regulated heavily by SEPA, and rightly so, to try and stop any environmental pollution. And there's no doubt the longer they leave metals on the ground, there's a danger of pollution into the soil. So I understand the pressures. I also understand the pressures of throughput and being able to keep things, you know, keep stacks of metal that are 48 hours is problematic for them as well. From an investigative point of view, it would be helpful. But I do understand the business considerations in, and the environmental impacts that, that retention period might bring on them.
Scotland. Yeah, Convener, thanks. It's just to echo John's comments here that being a bit parochial from an investigative point of view, whilst I understand that in lesser cases where scrap metal's going through metal dealers, that we don't get there within 48 hours, such as the cases of volume and gravity of metal thefts now, that there are cases where we do, quite frankly, take it seriously and expedite that investigative process. And I think in terms of the 48 hours that we're suggesting we keep, it's a good compromise and a good balance between our approach to investigating the more serious offences of metal theft and the business concerns that John's quite rightly highlighted there. So supportive of the 48 hours getting kept.
Thank you.
If we did lose the 48-hour requirement, though, there is the requirement within the proposed bill to improve record keeping. Would that in any way compensate for that, do you think, or would you still prefer to retain the 48 hours?
ACC Telfer, please.
I think in terms of best evidence, when I speak about the more grave cases of it, it would be beneficial for us to retain that best evidence. That 48 hours window of opportunity is particularly beneficial in relation to that, and to do away with that would, in real terms, be doing away with our opportunity to gain that best evidence and recover stolen, what is in effect stolen property.
Thanks, Convener. I think there is definitely a balance to be struck here, you know, and if the bill becomes an act, then there will be new provisions around much better record keeping with identification that will help and ensure that or reduce the anonymity. The ban on cash transactions, if that comes into being, then that improves the traceability. I would absolutely agree with Mr. Telfer around the best evidence, and if that is there. Actually, if you've been in a scrap metal dealer's and some of the bigger ones, the reality is, you know, there's metal all over the place, and you would need some fairly good processes that the dealers themselves sign up to that keeps the 48-hour stock, which obviously needs to keep moving. And that it's fairly clear when we go in looking for any stolen metals after a crime has occurred, for us to know exactly where that's going to be. I suppose what I'm trying to say is there's a number of ways in which they could get round that by not having the 48-hour stock in the 48-hour pile where we might expect to see it. So it's all a balance, Convener.
Alec Rowley, please.
He's trying to get that balance. I can appreciate what you're saying about best evidence, but how often is the police actually using that? I mean, the scrap dealers that came in here, particularly the larger ones, were saying it was really difficult for them to be able to do that. As you see, the process is moving stuff forward. But is it not the case that with these other steps that are being put in place around cash, around better record keeping, around photo ID, etc. Where is that balance? I mean, you know, is this one that you feel really, really strongly on, or is it something with all these other steps that are put in place? It might not get you best evidence, but these other improvements means that that will be compensating for it.
Chief Superintendent McBride, please.
It's a difficult one because there's the business need, as we've talked about. There's the environmental need that SEPA would certainly and rightly be concerned about, and there's the best evidence around the investigations. And certainly, if the metal is there and we can find it and we can identify it, given some of the challenges that Alison outlined, then that would definitely be the best evidence and would help it, help us. I think some of the safeguards that may come into being as the bill progresses may help us as well and may provide a compromise around that.
Superintendent Evans, there's no requirement in England and Wales for the 48-hour provision. How do you think that works there? Do you think it's an impediment that you don't have that in place?
I think in an ideal world, for us as enforcement agencies, we would have everything that we possibly could in place. However, in consideration of the 48 hours rule, it would help considerably. Obviously, not having it, we don't know how much it impedes us. We, as BTP, have the minimum standards that we get to the closest free scrap metal dealers within 24 hours. So with all the provisions that have been put in place, each one builds a step into making the traceability of stolen metal, improving that traceability. The 48-hour retention would be another step that would assist us. But we also recognise, because we do have consideration for BMRA colleagues, that for some of the smaller operators, potentially, it could prove very onerous upon them to accede to this as well as the Environment Agency requirements that are placed upon them. So we understand the business objections against us. Obviously, in our world, we would prefer to have as much assistance as possible to trace that metal.
And Police Scotland colleagues?
Well, given the gravity of some of the incidents in relation to metal theft, the time when it's reported, multiple locations, identifying actually what dealers they've taken the metal to, as I've already stated, we can cover the whole of Scotland. 48 hours, I would suggest, is a minimum to allow enforcement agencies to do any positive inquiry. And without that, it certainly would impede any investigation. So it's not necessarily that they'll go to the next nearest scrap metal to process the metal, because the thefts could come from, as I said, multiple locations. And we don't know that, so it does take time, and the removal of the 48 hours, I think, could be potentially significant.
Thank you. Alec, do you want to come back?
Not really. I mean, I mean that point, because the trade are obviously quite concerned about the 48 hours, particularly the larger dealers, and they're saying that their view is there is no practical benefit, and that record keeping can be just as effective. I mean, you would dispute that?
Well, I can understand where they're coming from, but that's if the record keeping is up to standard. They are checking identification, they are recording properly. And as I said, there are difficulties with any police inquiry building up to from when the incidents occurred to locating the stolen item, etc. And actually given 48 hours to complete to identify where the metal is isn't actually a long time for the police. And then beyond that, it's gone, it's easily disposed of. And if the records, as I said, haven't been kept and there's no CCTV, etc., then that makes it even more difficult for us to trace that back. So, in my opinion, it's a compromise between allowing an enforcement agency time to at least try and make that inquiry and investigation balanced against how long they need to keep it and comply with CPA, etc.
Please.
Like my colleague Willa Coffey was very impressed with the figures that you quoted from the reductions in England and Wales. Digging down a little bit deeper in that, you also mentioned that as well as the Licensing Act there, you've also got considerable amount of work in different industries. I was just wondering in the area of heritage thefts in particular, if you have seen similar reductions there, and really a comparison about whether that work that you do with industry is also paralleled in Scotland at the moment?
Yes, we work very closely with, certainly from our side, English Heritage. We work with people like Ecclesiastical Insurance, who the main insurers for churches, who look at the theft of lead from church roofs. So we get evidence from a variety of sources around the increase, decrease of thefts or whatever. So, yes, English Heritage will tell us that they have seen an incremental decrease in the thefts. Certainly, for ecclesiastical insurance, the amount of claims that they have had from churches for the theft of lead from their roofs has decreased over the period around 2 to 3 million. Over the period of the 3 years that we've had, 2011 to 2014, the period of the task force. So definitely we can say we don't just see it in the power networks, in the round networks, in media, but it's across the piece, if you like. The only gap to that, I guess, is around catalytic converter theft, which is kind of a side off to itself, and a side issue for this probably.
Just a quick question about this 48-hour. When we visited a scrap metal dealer, they said it would be quite easy to hide some of the metal that had been stolen and just push it aside and just give you a bit of it. They were not keen on it because also the area that could be stored in takes up valuable space. Would you like to comment on that?
Who's going to deal with that? Chief Superintendent
McBride. Yeah. I think those points are very true. You know, I've been in a number of scrap metal dealers myself, and I understand the challenges that they face in being able to store material. The other point, and I would imagine BMRA as the representative body of the industry may have raised this, the percentage of processed materials that are stolen, the BMRA would suggest is very small in terms of percentages, incredibly small, when you consider all the recycling that is done within this industry. So as a proportion, they would make a perfectly valid argument that 99% of their processed material is legitimate, is not stolen, and this would impose disproportionate burdens on them. It's hard to argue against that. I think what we've seen with some of the evidence I know the committee has received on some of the more major or more impactive metal thefts, when hospitals have had their power cut, when tens of thousands of houses have had their electricity supply affected, then that is when it's really critical for us to be able to get into yards round about the scene or round about the locus where the crime has occurred or further afield to try and get in to get that metal and then take the inquiry forward. That's when the pressure is really on us.
Police Scotland, do you have anything to add to that?
No, just as previously articulated, the only other way around that is perhaps even further tightening of the bureaucracy around that that maybe needs to be looked at if there was concern about the 48 hours. But I would be concerned about the removal of that, given the time for a police inquiry to be undertaken, particularly in significant issues with the metal being quickly moved on.
Thank you very much. Can I thank British Transport Police for coming to give evidence today? We're going to continue on with other aspects of the bill with Police Scotland colleagues, but thanks to BTP, and I suspend for a few minutes to allow you to leave. Thank you. With Police Scotland, with a focus on alcohol licensing, taxi and private hire car licensing, and sexual entertainment venue licensing. I intend to take this section by section, so we will deal with alcohol licensing first. ACC Nelson, do you have an opening statement about alcohol, please, sir?
Thanks for convening, and thanks very much for the opportunity to be here today to present evidence. As you said, I'll deal with the licensing of alcohol aspect first. You'll be aware the purpose of the licensing and regulation is to maintain standards and control activities which have the potential to be harmful. An effective licensing regime provides safeguards, promotes public safety and reduces the risk of criminality, and also reduces the risk of those linked with serious and organised crime who exploit legitimate enterprise, and that's quite an important aspect. The cost to society from poorly managed licensed activity, ranging from the sale and supply of alcohol right through to the theft of metal that we've just discussed, cannot be underestimated, and it can also place undue burdens in both the public and private sectors, as you're well aware. Recent case law, such as Breakthrough, which I'm sure we'll cover, has also frustrated both the police and local authorities' ability to tackle issues within the licensing industry that are not directly linked to the sale and supply of alcohol in licensed premises. This regulation and management of licensing is a key priority for Police Scotland and is pivotal to a prevention and intervention strategy, and we welcome the proposals outlined in the Licensing Bill, which seek to enhance the 2005 Act and the 1982 Civic Government Scotland Act, which will enable us to effectively tackle the impact of licensing within our communities and keep people safe. There's probably key elements that I'll skip over here in relation to part two of the bill, which seeks to improve regulation pertaining to the sale and supply of alcohol, as you're well aware. In terms of cost, the excessive consumption of alcohol, it's estimated to cost the Scottish economy roughly about £3.6 billion per annum. And this figure includes costs incurred by the police, Scottish Ambulance Service, NHS, Social Work, Criminal Justice, to name but a few. And I'd like to emphasise, in times of budgetary constraints, it is really concerning that the public purse and the Scottish economy suffer such a detriment as a result of the misuse of alcohol. There are many factors that underpin our poor relationship with alcohol, such as availability, accessibility and cultural attitudes, which I'm sure we'll discuss. And the bill outlines proposals to assist the licensing board to identify areas of over-provision and includes provision to include the whole of a board area as a single locality and consider terminal hours as part of their determination. However, one of the main aspects for Police Scotland is the irresponsible sale and supply of alcohol also being a contributory factor. On a daily basis, my officers regularly encounter incidents of violence, disorder, antisocial behaviour and domestic abuse, often linked to the overconsumption and overselling of alcohol. From a national perspective, 23.2% of young people engaged in rowdy and disorderly conduct had consumed alcohol. And convener, I do have additional quite stark figures that we could discuss later if you wish. I won't go through them at this present time. There is a particular problem in relation to children and young persons, and as you're aware, alcohol is an age-restricted product. It's often obtained by people supplying to children and young people through agent or by proxy purchase by unscrupulous adults. Drinking dens and alcohol-related youth disorder remain a big, big concern for local communities. Alcohol consumption by children and young persons also has an exponential impact on their health, educational attainment and future employability prospects, and it is imperative from our perspective that we have the ability to address youth-related drinking and subsequent manifestation. Under the current provisions, the licensing objectives only refer to keeping children safe, and we welcome the extension in the bill to include young persons. This will provide clarity to licensing boards and enforcement agencies around the sale of alcohol to young persons in relation to reporting and preparation of reviews. You will be aware there is a new offence of supply of alcohol to children and young persons, whereby currently it's not illegal to supply alcohol to a child or young person That new offence will allow us to take more robust measures to tackle the supply of alcohol to those underage drinkers and create a new offence to supply alcohol to a child or young person in a public place. If I can move on to the fit and proper criteria and spent convictions, and very briefly, this was removed, as you're aware, from the Licence in Scotland Act in 1976. The bill proposes to reintroduce a fit and proper test in respect of licensing applications, transfers, renewals, reviews and revocation of licences, and also outlines a proposal to repeal section 129 in relation to spent convictions and foreign offences. This is a positive move and will allow us, the police, to provide details of spent convictions and foreign offences, providing greater information regarding individual conduct for consideration by licensing boards. We welcome these proposals, however, in our opinion, it remains to be seen as to how this will operate in practice and how the proposed fit and proper test will correlate to the licensing objectives. Finally, in relation to Part 2, Convener, Section 48 of the Licence in Scotland Act 2005 is a provision in respect of interested parties, which includes any person who has an interest in a licensed premise as an owner or tenant or has management and control over premises. Whilst this section has never been commenced and the bill sets out measures for its repeal, having considered this part of the bill, our position is that it would be advantageous to retain and enact this piece of legislation, which would afford greater opportunities for the police to identify and disrupt serious and organised crime involvement in the licensing trade. And, Convener, that concludes my opening remarks in relation to this section.
That's pretty comprehensive, I have to say. I'm going to shift you off an area which, onto an area which you've not yet mentioned, and that is concerns that the committee has heard relating to club licences and occasional licences. Can I ask you if you have any concerns about the current regime on these matters and whether you think that area needs tightening in any way? Chief Inspector Stewart, please.
I'm aware that occasional licences will often be used to circumvent obtaining a personal entertainment licence for larger events. An occasional licence is a relatively cheap licence. I think it's about £10. And you can operate a music event, etc., from that. And I know there certainly has been concern from local authorities with regards to the use and frequent use of occasional licences. Occasional licences have also come to the fore with regards to serious and organised crime, in particular counter-terrorism, where an individual can obtain an occasional licence in order to fundraise for a particular faction that they support. However, that's based on intelligence and it's work that's going on there. However, I appreciate the main concern that may have been raised by SOLAR was the abuse of the occasional licences and some anomalies with the clubs. So,
in terms of occasional licences, I think this is very interesting for us because we've not heard this before. You're saying that they can be used by organisations, terrorist organisations, to raise funds for what they're trying to do?
Yes. I wouldn't say it's widespread. I don't want to raise any fear or alarm. However, there has been occasions where it's known links to organised crime have obtained an occasional licence under the pretext of a charity or a fundraising event. And obviously there's concern around that.
Convener, just to put some clarity on what Morag meant by terrorism, it's mainly in respect of domestic terrorism and terrorist groups normally affiliated with the Northern Ireland situation, which, as you're probably well cited, sometimes infiltrates the west of Scotland, their fundraising events.
Okay, I think you know that this brings something new into the equation. It would be extremely useful for the committee to maybe get some written examples of this without obviously compromising any ongoing operations. But if we could get more detail of that, I think that would be extremely useful for us. In terms of the club aspect of it, what we've heard from the licensed trade is that they feel that in terms of the club's uses of their licences and occasional licences, they're getting round the law that others have to comply with. Is that something that Police Scotland would agree with, and is that something that causes you difficulties?
It's certainly not anything that's particularly came to the fore with myself.
This is Telfer.
It's nothing that I'm aware of, but I'm quite happy to take that away from the table convener and
have a look at
Providing further information around about that.
Thank you. Alec Rowley, please.
You're going to be coming on the question, the over-provision, and try and seek your views on how you think that would be able to be used and benefit. On some of the evidence that we've had so far, it has been suggested to us that, for example, if a large supermarket comes along and wants to locate into a certain area, the attraction of jobs, etc., means that they will only have any real problem in getting being able to be there, locate there, and provide obviously a massive alcohol outlet. And so I'm just wondering, in terms of over provision, whether the police has a view in terms of licences, is it pubs, is it everything? I mean, how do you see that, and how do you see over provision and these proposals actually helping?
Thanks, convener. I think there's a balance to be struck here, and you've mentioned the attraction of jobs, job opportunities, but that has to be balanced with current businesses in place as well. And certainly, using your example of supermarkets, from my experience, the local authorities at a planning stage thoroughly scrutinise the additionality of a big supermarket in place and how that will impact on local businesses. And I've recently saw an example where a supermarket has been at planning stage been knocked back, and because of that over provision, not only relating to alcohol but other aspects of life. I think it's an important aspect to look at within each local authority area, and I'm quite glad to see that the whole local authority area will be taken into consideration in terms of over provision, because the availability of alcohol needs to be regulated in our opinion, and certainly in terms of the knock-on effect of alcohol being overly available, that is there for all to be seen, and I could certainly highlight some figures that would substantiate that in terms of offending behaviour, public health issues, etc. So to bring this answer to a conclusion, it's an important aspect for us that the number of premises available, whether that be off licence or on sales, is regulated in terms of each local authority area, and we're involved in those discussions.
Is there a sort of trend in this? If you take underage drinking, for example, are supermarkets better regulated? Is there a specific? Is it the corner shops? And is there other things that this legislation, regardless of the legislation, for example, I remember in Fife for a while they did this test purchasing, where they had young people going around basically, and if they were able to get in and buy the alcohol, the police were there. And is the legislation going to actually contribute to reducing the numbers of young people accessing alcohol, or is there other things that the police need to be doing?
I certainly think it will contribute. Any further safeguards that we can put in place are very, very welcome. We do still do the test purchasing operations throughout the local authorities area, and what I've tended to find is that in terms of compliance, our off sales are very, very compliant, and there's few cases where they've failed in having to be reported to a licensing board. Availability is our access to alcohol is a big issue for children and young persons, and that's mainly through agent purchase or by proxy. The additional offence of supplying to children and young persons in a public place is very, very, very welcome, because In my opinion, the opinion of Police Scotland, that has been a gap for 16 and 17 year olds. It's been a gap in terms of how we can address the public space, drinking den, the antisocial behaviour, because up until now, we've only been able to seize alcohol where an 18 year old is supplying to younger people. So the additional offence will assist us in addressing the public space aspect of that. Accessibility to alcohol, unfortunately, occurs in private space as well, within dwelling houses, and that will continue to be a problem for us in terms of young people, children and young people, being able to access alcohol within the home. There certainly is a carer parental responsibility there, and as things stand at the moment, if we come across aspects of that, we need to deal with it under the Children Young Persons Scotland Act in terms of neglect, etc., etc. So the new legislation in terms of public space, very, very welcome, but there will still be issues in relation to private space.
Cara Hilton, please.
Thank you. Just linking into what Alec asked about over-provision, in your submission you raised specific concerns about home delivery services, and I wonder if you could outline more about those concerns, services of supplying alcohol outside licensing hours. Is that a big problem? Is it a growing problem? And have you got any suggestions of how the law could be altered to better regulate in this area?
Who's going to deal with that? Chief Inspector Stewart, please. At present, alcohol that's purchased for home delivery, the purchase has got to be made during the normal off-sale hours. However, the alcohol can be delivered up till 12 o'clock at night and start again at 6 o'clock the following day. So it is effectively extending the amount of time that people have got access to alcohol. In my view, it would be better if the sale and supply and purchase, all these elements around home deliveries, were coterminous with current off-sale provision. So you wouldn't be able to have home deliveries after 10 o'clock or at 6 o'clock in the morning. In addition, we are looking at the issue with home deliveries, particularly for those that aren't licensed, that have gone into this realm and delivering it. However, there is scope and provision, I think, to tighten it up and make it coterminous with off-sale hours.
Telfer, do you have anything to add?
Only that dial-a booze, as it's more commonly known, is becoming quite a significant problem. Having just come from an operational environment, certainly the division I was covering, there was a few instances of it, whereby the tightening up legislation around about that would be very, very welcome.
It's kind of a new one in me, it has to be said. Cara?
No, it was a new one in me, so that's why I asked the question. That's fine, thank you.
Okay, thank you. John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. As a follow-up to that one, the question has been raised by Cara Hilton. The issue is, who is the supplier of alcohol after 10 o'clock at night and after 6 a.m. in the morning? Because that certainly is a new area that I'm aware of. ACC Telfer's comments about some issues around the sale of alcohol through, and a particular issue that was raised locally with me in my local area was you buy your curry carry out and you order up a couple of bottles of the local brew that's consumed in the area of Lanarkshire. So who is actually supplying from 10 o'clock at night to 12 o'clock and from 6 a.m. in the morning?
Well, the legislation permits the delivery of alcohol between those times. And for those that have a licence, I anticipate it would be your supermarkets that are delivering your weekly shopping along with whatever alcohol that you've purchased there, with the checks and balances in place to check the identification. What you've referred to, the situation in Lanarkshire, is fast food accompanied by alcohol would tend to be unlicensed premises to sell alcohol, which was what the situation Mr. Telfer referred to. They're unlicensed, so yeah, they fall out.
No, it's, as I said, it's just for mm-hmm. clarification, because and it's interesting that if you go into a supermarket, you can only buy alcohol from 10 a.m. in the morning to 10 p.m. at night. But if you make an order and you ask for that order to be delivered after 10 o'clock at night, you can include in that order alcohol. Mm-hmm. It's useful to get that on the record.
The purchase has to be made within
those hours, but you can get the delivery, so you can preempt what you think you might be consuming on a Friday or a Saturday night by getting them to deliver after 10 o'clock at night. The issue came up earlier about the occasional licences, and I'm not going to go into some of the discussion that we held earlier, but it does raise the question about the relationship Police Scotland have with the licensing boards in Scotland, and whether or not you mentioned Chief Inspector Stewart about the intelligence the police has in terms of some of the applications that are being made. And ACC Telfer made reference to the issue about the ownership of some of the premises, where licensed premises, someone makes an application for a license to operate licensed premises, but the ownership of the building belongs to someone else or some other organisation. What is the current relationship or the feeling towards the current relationship between licensing boards and the police? And are licensing boards taking full account of the information being provided to by the police before they grant licences?
Who's going to take a crack at that one first? ACC Telford, please.
I'll certainly speak in that. I would respectfully suggest that the relationship between Police Scotland and licensing boards has never been stronger. And I can say that, as I said before, having just come from a police division in Scotland, they do take full account of our observations, and we are represented at each sitting that they have. And to bring this to a quick conclusion, I'm very, very heartened with the way things are moving in terms of licensing, and the aspects of this bill will add to that, but relationships have, in my opinion, never been stronger. But I'm sure that Morag can speak from a central perspective.
No, I would concur with Mr. Telfer that the relationship that has been built across Police Scotland with licensing boards continues to develop and grow. We must remember that they are a distinct legal entity in relation to licensing. However,
John?
It's interesting because some of the evidence referred previously in previous evidence sessions, there was issues raised about whether or not police intelligence could be presented to licensing boards and whether or not licensing boards would take account of police intelligence, because what we heard is that in some boards which demand that there be evidence-based decisions rather than intelligence-based decisions. What would be your views on those issues? Because clearly the earlier example you gave of the occasional licences, then most of that would be, as I would understand, intelligence-based rather than evidence-based.
Chief Inspector Stewart?
I don't think it comes down to poor relationships. What it comes down to is an uncertainty from licensing boards to use intelligence and obviously risk legal action or a challenge to their decision. There's also discussions taking place about what kind of intelligence, what format, what form of words, so it's actually information, it's not really intelligence as such that can be presented. Some licensing boards are looking to establish what the provenance of the intelligence is, if it came from a covert human intelligence source, etc. However, there has been a short life working group set up. Included in that group is crime division, licensing, member licensing clerks and solicitors, and COSLA sit in that group. And it's something that we hope to work through and together come to some agreement about what can be taken forward in terms of intelligence in submissions to licensing boards.
Thank you very much, Kevin.
Thank you. Claire Adamson, please.
You mentioned earlier on about welcoming the additional crime of supplying alcohol to young people, but some of the evidence that we heard earlier was around the lack of enforcement of some of the current legislation, particularly in the few prosecutions that have been made for selling alcohol to an intoxicated person. So given that, you know, you did mention all the social and crime problems in relation to alcohol that we're all very aware of, would you care to comment on how that legislation is used at the moment?
Can I just clarify? I take it you're talking about the selling of alcohol to intoxicated patrons with a licensed...
Yes.
Okay. It's a difficult one to prove, and there is no definition for intoxication, and to actually ascertain who was the one that provided the alcohol, what stage they were when they came in, etc. So there are difficulties around that. However, certainly from a policing perspective, it comes down to further informing and training our officers and what their powers are and what they should be looking out for when they go into a licensed premises, how to conduct an inspection and how to work with the trade as well. So it's about that awareness raising, but there are difficulties around the definition for intoxication.
Just to expand on what Morag said there, there's also the training and awareness raising within the licence and trade itself, which we work quite furiously on. That's the proactive aspect, but the very point you raise is an issue, and the reactive aspect of that is if an incident does occur on licensed premises and it would appear that it is as a result of selling alcohol to an intoxicated person, we'll take the necessary executive action after that, bring that to attention of the licensing board, and take the necessary action once we establish what's happened. So there's a proactive stage in terms of training their own officers and the licensing trade, and there's a reactive stage as well where unfortunate incidents do occur.
Okay, thanks. Willie Coffey, please.
You know, just could I ask your views on the fit and proper person test again, please? I think you've, in your submission, you've welcomed it. I'd like to know if you would like it to be further defined, and should there be guidelines, and who should determine the information that makes up a fit and proper test assessment. Could you give me your views on that, please?
Chief Inspector Stewart.
Yeah. I'm in agreement with Mr. Telfer. Absolutely welcome the fit and proper test being reintroduced, and that will obviously mirror provisions within the Civic Government Act. Just as in the Civic Government, where there is a fit and proper test, it's not defined and it's not prescriptive, and I think this would be best, and it's best left to whatever regulatory committee is dealing with this, whether it's liquor licensing or in the civic world, to determine what is fit and proper based on previous convictions, which will now be further enhanced that we're able to take spent convictions. The only issue that I have is it will still be linked to the licensing objectives and the sale and supply of alcohol, but it will remain to see how that works out.
Okay. Mr. Telfer, do you want to add to that?
Whilst I agree with Morag's point of view in relation to difficulties that may occur in correlating it to licensing objectives, I think if we look at the five licensing objectives, they would probably cover all aspects of anything that you would see as happening in a licensed premise. Just to reiterate, the fit and proper person, the reintroduction of that is very, very welcome, and it will assist us in a number of fronts, not only within what happens in a licensed premises, but who actually has control, management or otherwise of those premises. And it may well be linked to serious and organised crime, which has proven to be the case in the past, and we can certainly have an impact on that front by the introduction of this legislation.
In terms of liabilities, the provisions require notification of interested parties. That's those with a general commercial or other interest in the licence is to be retained. Witnesses could be asked to outline their concerns if this requirement is removed from the 2005 Act, as in my briefing. Do you have anything that you want to say about that particular aspect?
Section 40A relates to interested parties. However, this piece of legislation has never been commenced. and the bill proposes to repeal this. It is my view that it would be advantageous to retain this piece of legislation. Quite often an interested party will be a tenant, and when you're looking at issues in a licensed premises, we're able to take action and know who the license holder is, and we're able to take action and know who the designated premises manager is. But if we don't have any legislation covering, for instance, who the tenant is and their involvement in this, then there's not much that we can do about that, bring them to account or check that they are indeed a fit and proper and appropriate individual. So particularly for if you're looking at organised crime involvement in licensed premises, it could impede what ability we have to tackle issues in this field.
Curious liability aspects of that which may have muddied the waters in that regard.
I appreciate there's been an amendment to the definition, and with a vicarious liability, the interested party thereafter becomes a designated premises manager. But we will check. A designated premises manager has to have a personal licence. That comes to the police to do background checks to then report back to the board. But the vicarious liability, but I'm quite content with this aspect. What you can have, if you can think of interested parties as tenants, you could have the owner of a building who will lease that to a business who will be the licence holder. The licence holder can then lease that to another, which is your tenant, and the licence holder could put in a designated premises manager. I know it gets a bit confusing. However, the police are able to take... The police are able to take action if the designated premises manager doesn't have control of his premises, and there's been numerous incidents. We're able to take the licence holder if they're culpable to a review. But the tenant remains out of that, and because that legislation has never been commenced, and quite often that tenant could either be linked to criminality, serious and organised crime, or just be involved in the poor management of the premises, we're not able to take further action in that regard, and if it's not enacted and it's actually repealed, it could hinder progress in that area.
Okay. What about where the liability itself, has that person liable for the offences committed by their employees, which is one of the things that some folk have argued about the difficulties of all of this?
Well, a DPM doesn't have to be in the premises. So I can understand from a certain perspective if through the vicarious liability they're responsible for that as an interested party and due to the amendments in the legislation. However, it is a DPM's duty to ensure that everybody is fully trained. But other than that, no further comment.
Okay, ACC Telfer, do you have anything to add to that?
No, nothing further.
Okay, Cameron Buchanan, please.
A licence holder has his licence taken away, if it's on the premises in a public house, for example. Can he get it back reasonably quickly, or what happens if nobody's got the licence? What happens to the premises? If the licence isn't in anybody's particular name, at the moment it has to be in a name, doesn't it?
He wouldn't hold a licence. The licence, the way that the 2005 Act was developed, was that it's actually the premises that has a licence.
Not the person.
Well, the person applies for that licence, but the licence would remain in perpetuity. So it could be transferred over.
It can be transferred to another person without penalty.
There's been issues with that in the past in terms of transferring premises, that it may well fall into the hands of a serious and organised criminal.
That's right.
And there's been some practical examples in a major city whereby we've cottoned onto that, and eventually four pubs have been closed as a result of that. But it's a long, unwieldy process in terms of transferring premises, and it's a loophole that we're looking to close.
Okay, thank you.
Can we now move on to taxi and private car hire licensing? Do you have any opening remarks on that, please, Mr. Telfer?
Thanks, Convener. I'd be pleased to know these are very brief compared to the last ones. We welcome the proposals to improve training in respect of private hire car licences, which will undoubtedly improve the standards, public safety, and facilitate greater consistency. Police Scotland also welcomes proposals to remove exemptions which currently apply to vehicles being used for the carriage of passengers under a contract for exclusive hire for a period of not less than 24 hours.
This, in our opinion, will facilitate greater consistency in respect of this business area and allow the police to provide comment and present information to the regulatory body, ensuring that the applicant is a fit and proper person, further promoting public safety and acting as a deterrent for those involved once again in serious and organised crime. And that's the very brief comments that I have, Convener. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Telfer. During the course of the evidence that we've heard, although there are supposed to be quite big licensing differences between taxis and private hire cars, it seems that in some local authorities, including the one that I cover, Aberdeen City, seem to treat taxi and private hire car licensing in exactly the same manner, which is not as is written in the Civic Government Scotland Act 1982. Do these different regimes, these different interpretations of legislation as it stands, cause Police Scotland any difficulties in terms of policing this across the country? Because it must be kind of difficult for some of your officers who are now working across local authority borders to deal with the different aspects in different places. Does that cause you trouble?
When a licence, whether it be a taxi or private hire car licence, is applied for, as consultee to the regulatory committee, we will receive that and we'll do the same scrutiny on applications and report back. Are you referring to in terms of operational out in the streets or in terms of...
I'm talking in terms of application and in terms of operation, where it seems that in some places private hire car licensing the actual policing of it, whether that be by yourselves or by the local authorities, seem to be exactly the same rather than the two regimes that most definitely exist in other places like here in Edinburgh or Glasgow.
No, it doesn't present us with any difficulties. The same scrutiny is applied to any application, whether it be a taxi or private hire car. In terms of operational, obviously the difference between a taxi and a private hire vehicle is that a taxi can uplift somebody from the street.
Mr. Telfer?
I think from a national perspective, greater consistency run about the application of the regulations in relation to both taxis and private hire cars would be welcome. And I do take your point and understand the difficulties it may bring where they're applied differently in different parts of the country. So we would welcome greater consistency across the country.
Thank you very much. Willie, please.
Much, Convener. It's sort of related to that question. I raised this last week at the committee where there was some media coverage on a taxi driver who had moved from one authority to the other. And then the first authority had a string of complaints made against him, but was not made known to the second authority where he'd made an application. What are your views on that, and how can we close that particular problem down?
Chief Inspector Stewart.
Certainly, I can understand how that's been a problem, and it's perhaps down to communication between each kind of police and area or local authority. However, we are developing a national licensing ICT system called Innkeeper, which will have every license, whether it be a premises licensing for alcohol, for a taxi, private hire car on that. That will be available to every police officer in Scotland. So when an application comes through, those details will already be there, and that will flag that up to that department and inform what response they put back to their relevant local authority.
Will it include things like complaints against a person that perhaps haven't went right through a process and been determined? So will it include that?
If the complaint's been received by the police, but if it's obviously gone to a local authority, they will hold that information. And again, that's down to communication to the police with regards to that to investigate.
Mm-hmm. So
we're currently holding dialogue with every local authority in Scotland with regard to Innkeeper to establish whether they would embrace that as well. And I think the very point you make about complaints getting made to a local authority, that would be a big seller for me, that we do share and record information that's disclosed to various agencies. So we're having that dialogue at the moment in relation to our national system.
How soon do you expect that to be in place, the new software that will do that?
Hopefully between May and June this year. So.
And every authority will be able to feed into that?
Local authorities will send us applications which we'll check. We'll keep that as a police database just now. However, I'm aware that there is a working group looking at a single system for local authority licensing as well, and it'd be ideal if it could interface with ourselves so that any kind of requests coming from the local authority could be directly electronically sent to that system. It's just more comprehensive and improves communications between the police and the local authorities.
Good.
So it's something that's been worked on in, just now.
Good. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Can I ask, will Innkeeper in any way interact with the I6 system that's going in place, or is that beyond your ken?
Chief Inspector Stewart. I'm not technical, but I believe, yes, that Innkeeper can be bolted onto the I6, which will obviously be of considerable benefit as well and make it a lot more efficient when we're doing background checks and responding back to local authorities.
And in terms of the interaction between local authorities and the police in some of these issues, have you come across any data protection issues which have actually stopped the level of communication that's maybe required and may have even led to some criminality?
Not that I'm aware of. I mean, there are ISPs between the police and the local authority, plus the police are statutory consultee in relation to civic and liquor licensing, so that exchange of information, where it's pertinent, it wouldn't be anything that's erroneous to that process that we would provide over. It's only where it's applicable.
Mr. Telfer?
I'm certainly not aware of any instances where that's occurred.
Thank you. Alec Crowley, please.
We've been taking evidence on this. There was mixed views about the number of unlicensed operators, just people out on the streets. I think one of the taxi operators said that in our major cities, basically the weekends in particular, there's a lot of that activity going on. What would your view of that be, and how do you police that?
Well, it's down to information from legitimate taxis and private hire cars. I've certainly had dialogue on a number of occasions with Glasgow TOA taxis, which is your Hackney taxis, that have raised this issue, and getting that intelligence and information in so that we can proactively target and enforce that, in addition to the intelligence that police officers can and our partners as well. And I know there have been a number of operations in conjunction with road policing to target these individuals that purport to be private hire cars and uplifting individuals in the nighttime economy area, because that is a particular risk. So,
just to add to that, Convener, you're right. Unlicensed operators, mainly in the big cities, mainly at the weekends, it's an issue that's been ongoing for a while. And to add to what Morag said there, it's built into every city centre policing plan at the weekend for a nighttime economy. So our cops are well briefed on what to look out for there and make the necessary interventions where they suspect it may well be an unlicensed operator picking somebody up off the street, but it is an issue.
Thanks. And the other question was this sort of bit in the legislation giving licensed authorities the ability to limit the number of private hire car licences within their area. Again, we had sort of a mixed response to that, because West Lothian Licensing Board, for example, said that they basically leave it to supply and demand, and they were really suggesting at the end of the day supply and demand would govern this. Is there a need for that to be there, do you think?
He's going to take that, Mr. Telfer,
In my opinion, you know, taxis serve a purpose in keeping people safe at the weekend, whether it be a taxi or a private hire vehicle, and that's getting patrons from licensed premises and those that go out and socialise home safely. And certainly the way that we operate taxi ranks and safe zones has been very, very beneficial in reducing the number of victims of crime in that city centre setting. So it's a difficult one for me to answer because I welcome the presence of taxis and private hire cars on our streets to get people home safely. But I do understand the balance that people need to make a living, and the supply and demand thing must come into being. So I've probably not given you an answer there, other than saying it's a good resource for us at the weekend to keep people safe. I don't know, Morag, if you've anything further to add.
No, I agree, and it's entirely up to, I think, the local authority, and it'd be quite hard to determine as well. However, they can impose limits on taxis, but it's certainly one for the local authority.
Adamson, please.
Going back just ever so slightly to the working party group that you mentioned with local authorities regarding the information share, it was just to get an idea of the scope of that. Obviously, Police Scotland would be the one body now, it's very easy for you to cover the whole of Scotland, but is that COSLA who are involved in that? And is it likely that all, obviously to be 100% effective, it would require 32 local authorities to sign up to it? Is there any indication of what the buy-in to that process is at the moment?
The short life working group is still very much in its infancy, there was a meeting last year, and this is the first meeting since then again to try and get a wee bit more momentum onto this. We appreciate that there will be other members that will be required to join, for instance BTP as well, and their involvement, but I would envisage that it would have to go out to get that agreement from them. So COSLA would cover most of the local authorities, but if SOLAR invited as well for an input from the licensing clerks, SOLAS as well. So it's just taking it incrementally just now, but obviously it would need to get that agreement. And you won't always get that agreement with every board area, but where we can, then that gives an opportunity.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I've got to worry when I hear the words short-term working group. John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning once again. It's just to follow up from Alec Rowley's question about private hire cars. The issue about unlicensed operators, the particularly app-based operators such as Uber, coming into the market, does Police Scotland have any particular views about, particularly about unlicensed drivers? And unlicensed cars operating in the streets of Scotland.
Who's going to go first?
I think it just follows on from what Mr. Telfer previously articulated. Anybody that's unlicensed and unregulated is a concern because we don't know who this individual is. We don't know if the vehicle that they're driving in is safe. So whether it's app-based or quite simply they're not licensed is a concern. And we will take robust action around that based on whatever information and intelligence is to hand.
Do you give an indication of what robust action you can take? Because some of the evidence we heard, and I know there's been challenges in other countries in terms of the operation of Uber-type organisations, but at the present moment, what robust action can you take against someone who uses an app to get a car to pick them up, an unlicensed car or driver to pick them up? What legal enforcement as it you're, is available to you to take against those types of operations?
Uber is certainly something I've became aware of in the licensing arena, and I'm aware that they do operate in London. I'm also aware that they've recently been banned from operating in France, Germany and India, and it'll be for a variety of reasons. One will be from the actual sector themselves, a threat to those that are working in that area, whether they be taxis or private hire cars. The other is because of their operating plan, their business model, where they will effectively engage with drivers to operate and, to pick people up, car sharing, and they actually effectively act as a broker, which seems to avoid having an operator's license or a booking office license. It's something that we're looking into just now. I sit in the National Policy Group for licensing, and it has been highlighted to us, and we've had discussions with the licensing department at St Andrew's House because of the number of concerns about unregulated drivers out there picking people up, the condition of the vehicle, what checks have Uber undertaken on those that they have engaged, whether they've not hired them because they're classed as self-employed. So there's a number of issues around about that, and I'd be quite happy to come back to the committee with some more information once we've pulled that together.
Part of the examination by this committee of the proposed legislation is to try and ensure that any legislation that goes through is future-proofed as much as it can be. Would there be any recommendations in relation to trying to ensure that we actually have something in place that can stand the test of time, even if that may be a short period of time, rather than have legislation that's put into place that within weeks of it being put into place may become unworkable?
Mr. Wilson is putting you on the spot there.
No,
you
no.
Can write back to the committee if there's anything that well, comes up that you feel would be helpful.
Yeah.
I'm sure
yeah.
Chief Inspector Stewart can answer yeah. the question. And
no, I can understand where you're coming from. And there's actually, to a more diluted degree, that there's a situation at the moment where you have a booking office, for instance, in an area, and they take online bookings, so they can take an online booking from somebody that stays out with that area at the moment. That exists just now. The difference being that we can challenge that because they're only allowed to operate in an area of which local authority has granted that booking office licence. So it would seem to me that Uber are bypassing that because they don't have that. And all they do have is, you know, an office there. So we are, as I said, looking into that just now and the potential ramifications across Scotland and how that's managed and how, you know, they'll have taxis operating effectively across the whole of Scotland via this app. And I'm quite happy to report that back to the committee in due course.
Take it back to something you've just said, because you've said something that which contradicts evidence that we've had just, I think, last week or the week before, where we were told that a booking office didn't have to necessarily be in the area where the taxis were actually operating. And an example was given where a booking office was in the borders of one local authority and the company was operating in another. So would that, under current legislation, not be allowed?
I understand that you have to have a booking office licence in a local authority where you're granted to operate. So I'd
again,
need to get back to you again to check it. I believe there is some case law around it, but I'd need to get back and check on
I think we need
that.
Clarification on that, because I think some of the licensing authorities and some, I think it was the licensing operator authorities only, not the operators, said that that was possible. So I think clarification is required
yep.
on that if we
I can include
that
report on
Uber.
Okay, Grant.
Convener, just a final question, and it is on the booking office scenario, because based on the evidence we heard previously, what would be the Police Scotland's definition of a booking office? Because I put the scenario at a previous meeting that it could be one person sitting in a room in their house in front of a computer and a smartphone. Would that be defined as the booking office as far as Police Scotland are concerned?
Well, a booking office, according to the legislation, is where you operate more than three cars and you organise, obviously, the hire of vehicles, etc. So that would be the definition of it.
So that's
regardless where it is.
So I could sit at night in my house with a smartphone. And as long as there's operating more than three cars, that could be defined as a booking
office. Well, you have to apply for a licence for a booking office, so it would be whether the licensing authority would determine that. It doesn't
right.
tend to be that, but it's up to the local authority again to licence a booking office.
Thank you very much.
I ask you around about the licensing of cars and drivers, which is obviously some concern to the committee if operators are going ahead and being unlicensed and maybe unsafe cars with maybe dubious people behind the wheel. As it stands at the moment, before any of these new operators enter the market, do you have any idea of how much criminality has arisen from cars and drivers who are unlicensed? and what kind of criminality that we're talking about?
I don't have any figures with me to date, but again, I can provide the committee with that. But certainly from intelligence that we hold, and Mr. Telfer will no doubt be able to add more from experience in Glasgow City Centre, is quite often it can be sexual predators or just opportunities. It goes from one extreme to another. However, regardless, if they're not regulated, we don't know that individual as a fit and proper person to carry passengers, potentially vulnerable individuals through the effects of alcohol, as they tend to target the nighttime economy because that's when most money could be made. So it is a concern.
Extremely useful because, you know, I believe that there have been some extremely serious crimes have taken place after folk have gone into unlicensed cars thinking that that's an easy way to get home. And I think if we had those numbers, it would be very, very useful indeed. Can we maybe move on then to sexual entertainment venue licensing? Mr. Telfer, do you have some opening remarks there, please?
I do, Convener. Thanks very much. The sexual entertainment venues, such as lap dancing venues, are currently licensed in terms of a licence in Scotland Act 2005. The subsequent case law that I referred to earlier on, Bright Crew, which was circa July 2011, that has significantly impacted on Police Scotland's and the licensing board's ability to address ongoing issues with this type of establishment, or indeed other premises licensed in terms of the 2005 Act, unless it's directly related to the sale and supply of alcohol. The proposed bill seeks in part to remedy this situation in respect of licensing of sexual entertainment venues. The proposal advocates a dual licensing system whereby the premises will require a liquor and civic license in order to operate. This indeed will provide the police and the local authority greater scope to ensure compliance with this business area and remove some of the barriers that have resulted from Bright Crew. That will better enable the police and partners to ensure the safety and well-being of those working in such premises and pursue enforcement activity where required. In principle, Police Scotland is supportive of the measures outlined in the bill. However, there remains uncertainty as to how the dual licensing will operate in practice. In that respect, licensing boards and regulatory committees have separate and distinct responsibilities for liquor and civic licences, and a situation may arise where a liquor licence is revoked and the sexual entertainment licence remains in effect. It would be beneficial if a mechanism existed whereby each regulatory body communicates and agrees matters such as terminal hours. There will also be two different inspection regimes in place, which may also impact on local authority licensing standard officers or the proposed civic licensing standards officers. It would be advantageous if respective powers are cross-transferable. To bring this to a conclusion, the regulation of sexual entertainment venues should also be a mandatory provision rather than a resolution that's in the bill, and not left at the discretion of each local authority. Such a situation would encourage regime shopping, whereby there may be a disproportionate presence of sexual entertainment venues in an area where this is not a licensed activity. We also believe that consensus needs to be reached in the definition for adult sexual entertainment, which would subsequently inform conditions of licence to improve standards in this industry, such as robust mandatory conditions outlining what and what is not acceptable, and promote a consistent approach across Scotland. That's my initial comments, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's move to the point that you made about the communication between, say, a licensing board who may revoke an alcohol licence and a licensing committee or other regulatory committee who may deal with the sexual entertainment aspects. You're saying that there would be difficulty if one part was revoked but not the other. One of the other things that we have heard during the course of evidence, which seems to be a real problem, is the advertising outside some of the venues, which of course comes under another regime, normally planning. Do you think in terms of the regulation, the whole holistic regulation of sexual entertainment venues, do you think that that should maybe come under one regime rather than this split all over the place? Is that your feelings? Chief Inspector Stewart?
With regards to directly outside the premises, I think that's something that could be taken into consideration in this regime with the dual licensing. The problem thereafter that you have is the fly posting elsewhere and other communications, and it's who would take responsibility for that. I think that's something that would need to be considered a wee bit more fully.
Fly posting and leaflets,
you know, directly outside the venue, posters, for instance, what's contained on that, what the content is, and then you have the fly posting in general throughout the remaining area.
But surely there's other pieces of legislation that could fly posting, and if the,
content,
the leaflets were offensive as well, surely there is some other actions you can take in this regard.
That's what I'm saying. There's two distinct things. There's the advertising directly outside the premises and elsewhere.
I think we are looking at the scope round about the premises themselves. Any other illegal activity in this regard obviously does not come within the scope of this bill. But, you know, I get where you're coming from in terms of some of those behaviours. Do you think, though, that it would be good to bring all of the regulatory regime over these venues into one, if you like?
I certainly take your point, Convener, and I do think it needs to be joined up. And the best way to do that is one regime, as far as we are concerned. Whether that's achievable or not is another matter for discussion, but that would be utopian as far as we're concerned. It would join things up and have that overview from one body.
Okay. Thank you very much. Is it on this issue, Alec? Yeah. On you go.
The question would be what would be the problem with licensing boards having this responsibility? Why wouldn't you do that?
Well, sexual entertainment venues are currently licensed under the Licence in Scotland Act. There has been difficulties and frustrations because of the decision of Bright Crew, which basically meant if it wasn't actually linked to the sale and supply of alcohol, it was ancillary conduct, then they couldn't tackle that, because licensing boards are only allowed to deal with the sale and supply of alcohol. So that's where this issue has arisen. And I imagine they're looking at sexual entertainment venues to enact this piece of legislation so they can tackle the issues in there, right, with the sale and supply of alcohol.
Cameron, is it in this point as well? Okay, right, let's continue on in that particular scenario. You mentioned there, Chief Inspector Stewart, that in terms of the licensing boards, they can deal with the alcohol licensing only. What would the situation be if, you know, a licensing board had a difficulty with, for example, a casino, which is providing something else, and maybe they're worried about the operation of that casino, but maybe not about the alcohol aspects of it. Does that create a dilemma with current legislation as well, in terms of what a licensing board could or could not do?
There's certainly a recent example in Glasgow where it basically came down to the alcohol side of things. That's why it was dealt with. And obviously you've got the Gambling Commission that would be able to look at instances in these kind of premises like casinos. It may cause some difficulty, but...
Okay, that's a bit of a left-field question anyway. Sorry for that. On this point, Mr. Wilson.
On this point.
Yeah.
I think it is relevant to, in this point, because what you've introduced is a fourth, potentially a fourth element in terms of the licensing regime. Because I know there's a casino in Glasgow that has a large, inside the casino has a large venue which they hire out to various organisations for parties and various other things. But what would be to stop them from hiring that out or using that within the casino venue for adult entertainment on a Friday or Saturday night as allied to the other activities that take place within that casino?
Well, that comes to my next line of questioning anyway, so you can answer all of this in a winner, and that's roundabout the premises that hold sexual entertainment on no more than four occasions per year, and that may be the casino that Mr. Wilson has just mentioned, where, you know, they have no need in some regards to follow the normal licensing regime. Do you have concerns about enforcement concerns round about that? And what's Police Scotland's views about occasional licences for one-off sexual entertainment events, or four-off, as it the case may be?
I think it throws up some concern and a potential loophole, and I know that Morag's put in comments before about potential for road showing, and for a particular group who provides adult entertainment to travel the length and breadth of the country but only have it in venues maybe once or twice and expose that loophole. So I would have concerns regarding the definition being three or less that you're allowed in any particular premises. And going back to Mr. Wilson's point about the potential for a casino holding adult entertainment as well, and you've got all these regulatory bodies that have oversight of their particular part of it, it throws up to me that it may become quite messy, and it's back to the original point about one body overseeing sexual entertainment venues and adult entertainment. So, but yeah, we do have concerns around about that particular point you raised, convener.
In terms of the policing of, you described maybe a around Scotland tour, which could happen with occasional licences. Obviously, it would be much more difficult for you folks to police what is going on there. Have there been difficulties in the past round about any of these kind of scenarios that you're aware of?
It was just one of the considerations when we were looking at the proposals in the bill. As Mr. Telfer articulated at the beginning, licensing is about keeping people safe for those that are working there and those that attend as a customer to these premises. If they were excluded because it was up to three or four occasions, whether it was in the operating plan for the license that I anticipate it would be, you're back to the Bright Crew decision again, which means that, you know, we wouldn't be able to effectively regulate or challenge that unless it's to do with the sale and supply of alcohol. So it would be better if that, you know, provision wasn't there and we were able to tackle that as long as it's catered for in a licence.
Will your innkeeper system be able to keep track of occasional licences in this regard, or in alcohol as well? Or is that going to fall out of the remit because you might not be aware of the occasional licences that are granted?
The occasional licences would be contained in the innkeeper system and would be linked to that premises. However, I would rather that there wasn't an exemption and that if they were wanting to undertake that activity, they had to get the licence for it so that we knew that was coming in, and it was also outlined in the operating plan for the liquor licence as well. So that means it joins up that information.
Thank you very much. Cameron Buchanan, please.
It seems to be a bit of a minefield, and there's a bit of an anomaly here between places of sexual entertainment on an occasional basis, or if it's phoned up, telephoned up, and booked a strippogram or something. Have you got concerns about this? I mean, is it, if it happens regularly in a premises, so somebody's doing it weekly or monthly, they're obviously holding it privately or for financial gain. What are your concerns about that? Are there any?
Who's going to take that one on? Mr. Telfer?
If you wish, I think that gets back to my final point in my opening remarks round about the definition of adult sexual entertainment, and we really need to be quite concise round about that in terms of what that is, and if it includes the strippogram stuff that's ongoing in a weekend basis for stag and hen parties and such like, well, so be it. But I think we need a bit of dialogue around about that definition to see what actually falls within that.
Simple answer to it, really, realistically. You have concerns, but there's no answer particularly to it that you can enunciate here.
I don't think there's a particular answer to it at this moment in time. We do have concerns about it. There's not been particular examples of the type of situation you spoke about for the stag and hen party throwing up any significant issues, so it would be very much a case that there's no evidence base here for maybe including that, but it's quite contextual. It depends on what situation. It's really quite a grey area at the moment, as you highlight.
So is what you're saying, it's discretionary a bit, realistically, as far as you're concerned, is it?
There needs to be an element of discretion, but once again, there needs to be some concise definition around about this adult sexual entertainment that will assist us in policing what is an issue. But most of our issues out of places where lap dancing takes place is around about the vulnerability and exploitation of some of the employees there, and it flies in the face, certainly, of the Scottish Government's approach to the victimisation of women, etc. So that's where most of our concerns have been in the past.
And in terms of criminality out of sexual entertainment venues, there have been lots of allegations that it attracts a criminal element. Is that something that Police Scotland would agree with, or is the amount of activity that much different from, say, nightclubs or other venues?
It's certainly... It's a place that does and will attract certain elements of criminality, just because of the sheer nature of it and the potential to generate income for organised crime groups. There's potential in various licensing establishments for that to happen. It's just another opportunity for them, and it's been shown in the past that we can show direct links to a particular crime group, and they're exploiting that for probably illegitimate purposes and perhaps laundering money.
Again, it may be useful for the committee to get an idea of the crime figures round about some of the places, so that we have an indication and maybe a comparison with some others as well.
We'll do our best in that one, convener. There's certainly difficulties in terms of the current administration of these venues, that there's different approaches to that in different areas, as we've highlighted previously in relation to other issues. So we'll do our best in providing those figures.
Grant, can I thank you very much for your evidence this morning? Could I ask you just to keep your seats just for a few seconds, and can we move on to agenda item 2, and that is for the committee to decide whether to take consideration of the following items in private at future meetings, and those are consideration of our work programme, consideration of EU priorities for 2015, and approach to budget scrutiny for 2015. Are we all agreed?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now move into private session. I suspend the meeting.